because of it. The bebop revolution in the language that was developed out of there, the prowess on the instrument, really transforming jazz into an art form, making it something where if you could actually play bebop and you could actually play these melodies and play these advanced harmonies and really have just the technical virtuosity on your horn, those things actually transform the entire landscape of music. Even now today, musicians all around the world aspire to be bebop musicians. It doesn't matter what idiom that you're in, when you hear bebop musicians play and you hear their harmonic prowess on the chord changes and their advanced harmonic approaches, that is like the high end of music and the high end of intellectual art form in terms of how we improvise and how we get around the instrument, how we interact with the chord changes, how we interact with the rhythm section. And it really just changed everything about how it is that we approach music today. It also is the cornerstone of what we teach in universities across the United States and in the world. We train people on the bebop language because it's so advanced and harmonically advanced. And we're just try to slowly get musicians into understanding what is it that bebop is? Why is it called bebop? Where is the language developed? And who developed the language? Who were the pioneers of bebop? How many people know and like bebop? Yes, it's not a music for everyone. As you'll see, some of the musicians, even of the time in the swing era, called bebop music Chinese music. They didn't understand it. It just sounded like blah, 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 blah. And they didn't really, it wasn't like like the swing era. It was more like, you know, these kind of really advanced languages. Also the melodies, which are, and the melodies of a song, which we call the heads of the song, were so advanced and so extraordinarily difficult to play that one of the things that it did was actually separate finally the musicians from the rest of the herd. In the swing era, as we developed through the swing era and all of the great things, and we all love the swing era and all the dance music and stuff, the swing era became so commercialized through the 30s that all the musicians were now starting to homogenize into this coalesced thing of swing dance music, big band music. And it became so homogenized that there became little room for individual expression. And also, average musicians could pop on swing band music and hop on a swing band, dance band, and they could play and they were included in the herd. However, as we start to get into bebop, what we have is we have this separation where we wanted to be able to distinguish ourselves as musicians beyond this swing area thing, this homogenized, commercialized dance band stuff that kind of was very stifling for many musicians. And we wanted to separate ourselves. So if you were on the bebop bandstand, it didn't matter if you were playing in the best big bands in the world, you really had to have some serious technical ability on your horns, and you had to have some serious technical and harmonic advanced knowledge of music. And bebop and the harmonic knowledge, a lot of people don't understand, actually is taken a lot of from classical music, from Debussy, Ravel. Some of these harmonies, as jazz musicians were analyzing them and going, what were they doing? What were these people doing? And we took some of those advanced harmonies and we said, how do we put that into a bebop language? How do we express that in the jazz language? And that's kind of how bebop came about. I have a wonderful PowerPoint for you this morning, and we're going to talk about some bebop musicians and talk about, I got some music to play for you and some cool stuff and some bebop musicians of today. But when we talk about bebop musicians, we're talking about players like Charlie Parker. How many people have heard of Charlie Parker? Yeah, a lot of people have heard about Charlie Parker. We're talking about Dizzy Gillespie. How many people have heard of Dizzy Gillespie? He's one of our big patrons. And then we have some Miles Davis and Bud Powell, Thelonious Monk. We have musicians Max Roach, Kenny Clarke, Coleman Hawkins, John Coltrane, which a lot of you have heard of, J.J. Johnson on trombone, Sonny Stitt on sax, Dexter Gordon on tenor, Art Blakey on the drums, who was like one of the big, huge proponents of excelling young jazz musicians into the forefront. Even Louis Armstrong in his later days played just a little bebop. We have Clifford Brown, singers like Sarah Vaughan, Charles Mingus on bass, Sonny Rollins, if you know Sonny Rollins, great trumpet player Fats Navarro, one of the great bebop singers, Ella Fitzgerald. We have Mary Lou Williams in some cases, and we have Lenny Tristano. Stan Getz, even though he was bossa nova, was also a bebopper. We have the modern jazz quartet. We have Roy Hines. We have James Moody, players like Lester Young, advanced players that evolved out of that, like Chick Corea of our modern times. We have pianists like Earl Father Hines. We have bassist Ray Brown. We have other players that evolved out of that, like Horace Silver, and trumpet players like Kenny Dorham. We have players like Freddie Hubbard, who dominated the bebop scenes. And we have Lionel Hampton, one of the greatest saxophonists of all time, Cannonball Adderley. How many people have heard of Cannonball Adderley? Just curious. Yeah, one of the greatest, most incredible lead alto players of all time. And these players kind of transformed the landscape so that people of nowadays can go back and trace it back. As remember, we started in the 60s, we're going back, now we're into the 40s, and we're talking about the bebop revolution. In our next classes, we're gonna go back in the 30s, we're actually gonna work backwards so that you can see where all of this music actually came from. And at this time, I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen. We're gonna talk a little bit about bebop. But first of all, I wanted to get just some views from the crowd. And you don't have to have a sophisticated view. It can just be your personal view. Tell me what you think bebop is. And does anybody have an opinion on what bebop is? Or how about your favorite bebop players? Any participants? How about David? David Hickey, how about you? Hope your sound is off.
Can you unmute, David? There you go.
Oh, bebop is kind of a mix of things for me. I don't really know that much about the terminology. And so it's very nice to have you give a little bit more illumination to what differentiates bebop from what I consider mainstream jazz. I think that the artists you just mentioned, many of them are familiar. John Coltrane, you started out with, I believe it was...
Charlie Parker.
Charlie Parker. Of course, we all know Birdland, and we know, so many variants of that over the years in terms of the modern jazz idiom. I don't know, though. I don't know. I love to hear some of the artists that you mentioned, especially Ella Fitzgerald, of course, and some of the other vocalists as well. I think Ella would be my favorite bebop because she does the idiom so fluently.
So. Right on. Well, ironically, Charlie Parker and Birdland, that was the first jazz club actually named after a jazz musician. And to think about that, Charlie Parker was a living legend. He had this club named after him while he was alive, which was really, really a kind of a different thing. Ella Fitzgerald was also one of the modern bebop singers. And what she did, and a lot of people don't know, is Ella Fitzgerald had perfect pitch. So she could actually sing through some of the chord changes and some of the advanced harmonies. And people would say, oh, you want to play, the sharp 11 on this. You want to sing the flat 9, the sharp 9, the flat 5, the sharp 5. And she could actually sing those things, which was really, really extraordinary. How about you, Jordan? You had your hand up.
I did. So I developed the taste for bebop from my older brother, who was really into it. So I got the chance to listen to a lot of the musicians you spoke of. But the one I think that really most struck me was Lionel Hampton. I got to see a concert of his as a young man, and I have really been enamored by his music ever since.
Right on. Yeah, bebop is one of those things where if you're listening to it on the radio by yourself, you know, it doesn't really, you're like listening, oh, here's, listen to some bebop, and you're like, oh, that's kind of, you're not used to it, and oh, I'm not sure whether I like it, where are the lyrics, you know, all those kind of things. But if you actually watch bebop musicians live, and you watch them do it in person, you see an actual human being play at this techno virtuosity, it brings a whole new meaning to what bebop was. It's kind of like the difference between watching hockey on TV or watching hockey live, or, you know, watching gymnastics live, you know, things like where like you're seeing it in real hand in person, you're watching a human being actually go, and you're like going, wow, that's extraordinary that a human being can do those things. How about anybody else? Any comments on bebop or your favorite players? How about this? How many people can name 5 bebop players? All right, well, we're gonna learn some things today. I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen and we'll get right into some of the music. I also have some of my bebop solos and transcriptions that I'm gonna play for you. So you can hear some on the EVI and some on the trumpet. I have some Dizzy Gillespie prepared for you, some Charlie Parker to take us back, and just some nuances, a little film on bebop so you can understand what people are saying about it, a little clip from Wynton Marsalis, little 2-minute clip talking about bebop, and kind of give us this whole thing so you have a better understanding of what this music is, how it transformed our music of today and forever transformed the landscape of music to come, and the harmonic advancedness by which bebop players go. So sharing my screen right now. And how about that? Can you guys all see that?
Yes.
All right, the bebop revolution. I love the word revolution because it really was one of those things that changed things, kind of like the Harlem Renaissance, and a revolution in the terms of where everything after it was different, everything, the whole landscape was changed. The bebop revolution, well, it's the early 1940s. We had World War II going on. There was a lot of things going on in the 1940s, things that were forever changing the landscape. Also the swing era and all that stuff, and the bands that were playing for the militaries and going across and, you know, being ambassadors to the United States, and how this kind of changed. It was, the swing era was in full bloom and a musical revolution was brewing. So with the bebop revolution, new ideas were coming together from a diverse cast of creative young musicians in after-hour jam sessions. An environment of experimentation and spirited camaraderie, bebop is the first modern jazz style was born. It was frantic, difficult to play, and for many jazz fans, difficult to listen to. As a matter of fact, a lot of swing musicians, when bebop came in, they completely rejected bebop. They didn't want to hear it. They thought that the players were outside of the realm. It wasn't necessarily a dance music anymore. Whereas the swing era, everybody was dancing and they loved the music and it was mainstream and it caught everybody's attention. It was kind of like the equivalent of Elvis Presley. It was the rock and roll, the swing era was, of music. Whereas bebop, all of a sudden you had to actually have an advanced listening skills. You were no longer there to dance to the big bands and have them entertain you. You were there to watch art form. You were there to just sit and listen in the club and become active listener and participant. Most of the leaders of bebop were defiant, rebellious, and disrespectful of authority, as we know. And the emergence of bebop was a broad reflection of some important changes that were beginning to surface in America. And some initially criticized bebop, but it was too big a force to ignore. And bebop changed jazz from popular dance music to an intellectual art form, which is really, really cool. I'm gonna play a short clip, just 2-minute clip of Wynton Marsalis talking about bebop. Hold on a second.
Oh yeah.
Here. And there's a 1-minute clip here.
In the 1940s, a couple of new instrumentals.
Oops, I'm gonna go ahead and share my sound. Hold on. All right, is everybody seeing Wynton Marsalis on the screen? All right, here we
yes.
go.
Yes.
Geniuses arrived on. In the 1940s, a couple of new instrumental geniuses arrived on the jazz scene. Alto saxophonist Charlie Parker from Kansas City and trumpeter Dizzy Gillespie from South Carolina. Oh, they played faster, more complicated and intricate lines than had ever been played before. The new style was called bebop. It's very hard to play and to sing bebop. But don't think that this stopped the jazz singers. Oh, no. They were going to insist on and bebop is perfect for that because the name bebop actually comes from the vocalization of instrumental lines. So if I go, I was saying, a bebop. Musicians began to play bebop in the early 40s during World War II. It changed the playing of and listening to jazz in so many fundamental ways that many fans consider the invention of bebop to be the beginning of the modern era of jazz.
All right. So that's kind of, you're hearing about Wynton Marsalis talking about jazz and we're talking about bebop. Bebop, ba-doo-bop, ba-doo-lee-you-bop. And a lot of people, a lot of vocalists out of the time developed this language. If you had like the melody of Donnelly, you would think that was a solo, right? That's actually the melody of a tune. So imagine trying to learn that melody of the tune on your instrument, and you had to memorize it to get on the bandstand. This kind of melodic and virtuosic melodies separated the herd. It's like, okay, wait a minute. If you can't play this melody on your instrument, you now can't step up on the bandstand. You can't just be a swing player. It's like you have to really, really be able to execute on your horn. And what vocalists did is vocalists picked up on all of those lines and they started transforming those lines into a vocal vocabulary as well. The modern vocalists today and jazz singers today all study bebop and study bebop players to elevate themselves into the art form. Sharing back my screen here and going to my PowerPoint. Bebop's influence is pervasive to this day. Its melodies, rhythms, harmonies, and repertoire are still studied by jazz musicians and are intertwined in the very fabric of all modern jazz. And in the beginning, bebop was a revolution whose repercussions brought turmoil to the jazz world. A lot of it too. It separated it and it literally split it right down the middle. And others embraced it. Still others initiated a nostalgic backlash against it. And bebop ended up being an evolution as well as a revolution. All right, hold on, y'all. With the arrival of bebop, the playing field was suddenly titled in a disoriented way. Many musicians like alto saxophonist Art Pepper, this is an interesting thing, felt threatened. Upon hearing his first bebop recording after returning from the war, because a lot of the swing musicians, a lot of the swing bands that had, you know, established players when World War II hit, these musicians were drafted. They had to go and they had to leave these big bands. So they spent some time away from the bandstand. And when they came back, this whole new music had started and they felt like they were completely left behind. And Art Pepper said, these guys played faster. They really played. Not only were they fast technically, but it also had meaning behind it. They swung. They were playing notes I had never heard before in the chords, and it was more intricate, more bluesy, more swingy, more everything, and it scared him to death. And I can imagine, it was like the first time I went out to North Texas and I heard all the bebop musicians, I was like, oh my gosh. I remember calling my mother and saying, Mom, I don't think I'm ever gonna be able to do this. It was so extremely difficult. I'm sure we've had moments in our lives as we pursued our careers where we all of a sudden realized where the top end was and we're like, wow, am I gonna be able to do this? Now, interesting enough, the American Federation Musicians Recording Band, wow, this had a huge impact. Let me ask you this, how many people know about the American Federation of Musicians Recording Band in the 1940s? Anybody know about that? Okay, well, I'm gonna tell you a little bit about that because it has a huge impact on why we didn't see the incubation period of this bebop revolution. Many musicians were caught off Gambolardo's complete absence of bebop recording during the music's developmental stages. The American Federation of Musicians ban on recordings by its members on August 42 to 1944 neatly coincides with the new music gestation period of this bebop music. Chances are, if you weren't in Harlem during this time, you probably would not have heard any bebop until the first bebop recordings were made in 1944. So if you're living across the rest of America, you have this whole bebop revolution happening. The only thing that's going on in the music is in the 1940s, they start adopting vocalists as being one of the mainstreams on the bandstand. And this had to do with the fact that the American Federation Music Recording Ban, they wanted all musicians to get paid if their music was played on the radio. So if you had a big band full of 15 people, they wanted all 15 of those musicians to get paid. And so they had the recording ban. So you didn't actually hear this amazing gestation period of when bebop began until about 1940-45, when all of a sudden the ban was lifted and these bebop could be broadcast on the radio. An author and historian, Scott Vaux, put it, "The recording ban falls like a curtain in the middle of the most interesting part of a play. By the time the curtain rises, the plot has taken an unexpected turn and the characters are speaking a new language." So that's kind of like what the recording ban was. Ironically, also not here in this PowerPoint, is the Latin music, the infiltration of Latin music into our mainstream bebop and mainstream jazz happened and coincided at that same time. So these Latin music and percussions and salsa and all that stuff that were happening, Dizzy Gillespie, for example, had an amazing Latin ensemble band during the time of the recording ban that never got recorded because of the fact that the recording ban was on. So you're missing the whole beginning periods of when all of a sudden this Latin music started. We probably would have still been studying those recordings today as an evolution, much like we still study Stan Getz and Antonio Jobim with the influx of the bossa nova. We actually have the beginning. We can see where these first recordings and the first start of the bossa nova happened here in America. But we don't really have that in the 40s with Latin American bebop, and we don't really have that for bebop of the ingestation period. Any questions so far about what we're covering there with bebop, or any questions? All right, well, I'm gonna do a shout out to Keith, because Keith is always, he's my executive producer on the jazz series. And let me just ask Keith, what is your concept of bebop, and what are your feelings towards this music?
I'm always amazed at the capabilities of the bebop musicians. I mean, to listen, you just can't quite imagine how it would go. As a drummer, I had a hard time with it because I never played it. But I'd listening to it because I couldn't ever figure out how in heaven's name you would ever put a drum beat to any of that. In what I've listened to, what they do is kind of little dings and stuff here and there where so that seems sort of totally random to me. I'm impressed with the technical parts of bebop. As something I want to listen to, it's much too busy. I want to hear much more relaxing music, and there's lots of jazz that comes after the bebop period that is that way. Certainly a lot of blues stuff is that way, but you know, the technicality aspects of it are unreal sometimes.
Yeah, you know, it's an interesting thing that you say that, because most people don't like to listen to bebop. So when I became a bebop player and started playing bebop, my audience shrunk. It's like people were like, "Well, I don't really get that music, and it does sound really random." And the first time I started studying bebop and hearing it, I thought the music was random. I thought these people are just playing whatever they want. But as you study transcriptions, you realize it's extremely specific. These people are outlining the chords Absolutely, directly. You don't even understand that through all of these nuances, they're actually hitting all of the chords on the thirds and sevenths, usually on the downbeats of the chords, and playing through the chords. And so you start to realize, when I started like going through bebop transcriptions and looking at Charlie Parker and looking at John Coltrane and looking at Clifford Brown, it's like, oh my gosh, the intent was so specific that these people actually knew what they were doing. They knew what they were playing. And again, they were separating the herd. You say you're a drummer. Interesting enough, at the University of North Texas, bebop drummers had to learn all of the melodies on the drums. So if you're playing Confirmation, you know, by Charlie Parker, you had to. So if you couldn't play the melody on the drums at North Texas, you couldn't pass the improvisation classes. So you had to figure out how to play these bebop melodies using the toms, the snares, the cymbals, the hi-hat, the sides and equipment of the drums. And it became kind of a very specific thing. Most musicians, when they enter the jazz realm, when they hit the bebop wall, it's what I call a rude awakening, because it's like, wait, this isn't accidental. It's actually very intentional. It's very artful and all that stuff. Any other comments on bebop so far here? All right, David, go ahead. And then we'll have Roy next. Oh, your sound is off there, David. Hey, David, your sound is off.
Can you hear me now?
Sure can.
Yeah, I'm just following up. There was a comment on chat just now, which I was found very interesting. The person asked, what's the difference between bebop and scat? And of course, that in the context of Ella Fitzgerald, we all relate to her use of scat often in many of her tunes. And so can you give us a little bit of background on scat?
Sure, absolutely. Well, scat music, where singers started learning how to scat is they started emulating the great giants of bebop. They started actually singing their solos. Nowadays, modern jazz singers actually sing the entire transcriptions of solos. Like if Charlie Parker sang a solo, they're learning it on their voice and learning how to scat. And that gave him the rhythmic complexities to learn how to be able to scat. Now you don't know this, but if I had my horn in my hand, I can play literally exactly what I just sang, because I'm seeing the harmony of the transcription. I'm seeing the actual, okay, I'm on the four chord. And so a lot of times in my clinics and lectures, I'll say, hey, I'm going to play a bebop line. I'm going to sing a bebop line. Okay, now I'm going to sing a bebop line and I'm going to play it back to you exactly what I sang. It's not accidental. So a lot of these bebop singers, their vocabulary was developed directly from the instrumentalists. There are no bebop singers to date that have ever evolved that developed their own language. They all got it from the bebop horn players.
Horn players, oh.
Yep. All right, anybody else? Okay, moving on, and we're gonna listen to some more examples here with all that stuff. The new breed of jazz musicians. Well, there's some other things to consider here. The racial inequities of the music business during the swing era had allowed white dance band musicians to earn comfortable livings while denying the same economic opportunities to Black musicians. Black swing bands were routinely forced to play lesser paying gigs, had to travel further to get to them, and in particularly in the South, had to deal with racial inequities, stereotypes, segregation, and in some cases, violence, of course. It was becoming increasingly clear that many young, creative Blacks who played in dance bands were playing a white man's game that was never going to negotiate them for their talents. The world of swing simply wasn't working for them. And that's kind of how this music happened. The informal setting of the jam sessions allowed them to completely shake the notion of being entertainers, of playing someone else's amusement. And here they could play only music for themselves. Now at this time, I'm going to go ahead and play for you some other musicians, and we're going to take a little listen. How many of the two, how many people out there know the tune Just Friends? Just friends, lovers no more. Just friends, just not like before. If you ever heard Gary Langford play, how many of you heard Gary Langford play on trumpet? Gary Langford's one of his favorite tunes is Just Friends. So you've probably heard it, but I'm gonna play you a version of Charlie Parker to hear, take a listen to, and you'll hear kind of the harmonic prowess of Charlie Parker. I'm gonna kind of skip a little bit of the melody, but you'll hear a little bit of him. So you're hearing all those notes in there, right? And all those harmonies. Well, what we find when we actually transcribe Charlie Parker, we transcribe exactly the notes he played. We sit down, we write them out, we write out all the rhythms. We find he is actually outlining the harmony at a very high level with triads, with the chord extensions, third to flat nine. He has all of these really complex harmonic chord extensions beyond just the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. He's using all the extensions of the chords, the nines, the sharp 11s, the 13s, the flat fives, the sharp fives. And he's doing it at a tempo and a time that is almost inconceivable at the time. So that's kind of thing. Ironically, I'm listening to that Charlie Parker recording with the strings on it. And Charlie Parker was actually the first musician to record bebop and stuff with an orchestra, with the actual orchestra behind him and with strings. So it was a real big, huge kind of culmination of, wow, we have this amazing bebop player who came into the scene and he actually is like adding all these orchestral elements to this wonderful music bebop. To this day, Charlie Parker with strings is one of the most profound albums. You know, him playing along with string orchestras, it's just such an incredible sound that the people have. How many people enjoy that little Charlie Parker, Just Friends? How many of you recognize the tune? A little bit? If I had a singer sing it, you'd probably be like, oh yeah, I recognize it. Because Charlie Parker, as a bebop player, is playing all around the melody. He's not going ba ba like a swing player, ba ba boo ba do ba 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 do ba do da ba do day. No, he's going ba 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 do little 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 ba ba do da da sa do little 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 in the middle. I've got some awesome other little musical examples for you. Let's get back to the PowerPoint. Anybody have any questions at this point? All righty. So let's get back into here. The bebop counterculture. As the jam scene coalesced in the 1940s, a counterculture set in that was designated to keep away outside intruders. They didn't want, and for the sake of racial stereotypes, they didn't want successful commercial white musicians to be able to just come and take their music away again. To take, as it was with the swing era, where we had Louis Armstrong, we had all these bands, we had the Hot Five, and then all of a sudden we have the original Dixieland band that comes in to make the first jazz recording, who was all white musicians, basically stealing away the music, commercializing it, making money out of it. Well, they didn't want that to happen. So they wanted to be able to separate so that they could have no what they called imposters on the bandstand anymore. No one just, you know, taking their music. They started to dress differently. They had their goatees, they had their sunglasses, they had their berets. To this day, when I see young musicians all of a sudden getting their hands on bebop, like especially in the jazz band or in other cultures and stuff, and they start to become bebop players, guess what happens? They start wearing sunglasses on gigs. They start wearing little berets, their hats to the side. Some of them all of a sudden get earrings. They all of a sudden start dressing. They want to separate themselves, not only musically, but they want to separate themselves as an image as well. And this kind of bebop thing that we see now that young players study still perpetuates itself today. We're like, oh, I'm a bebop player. Now I get to wear my sunglasses on the gig. You know, it's kind of one of those cool kind of things. And of course, during the bebop era, we have one of the downsides is the major use of narcotics started infiltrating the bandstand. A lot of players wanted to emulate Charlie Parker. They knew he was the new messiah of music. Nobody was playing like Charlie at the time, except for Dizzy Gillespie was coming around and stuff. So they were asking themselves, how does Charlie Parker do that? Why did he do that? And of course, Charlie Parker was doing heroin. He was doing a lot of it. And so a lot of musicians tried to all of a sudden, well, maybe I'll be able to play bebop like Charlie Parker if I use heroin. And so we had this whole kind of this drug infused thing happen in the bebop counterculture, which eventually got itself out as people learned that that was just drug use and had nothing to do with the music. But we do see a pervasiveness during the bebop era as it came onto the scene. And we see a lot of musicians go to the wayside. We see a lot of tragic, destroyed lives. I can go through a list of jazz musicians in the bebop era that had extensive drug problems. And it became kind of something we had to root out of the music from the very bottom. But it was very popular, Charlie Parker and this new revolution. So people wanted to jump on the bandstand. To gain entry into the bebop counterculture, one had to first hold your own in late night jam sessions. You had to prove that you could be there. You had to know those melodies. You had to sit home and memorize them for hours. Bebop insiders deliberately tried to embarrass and discourage those who played with them. That still happens today. When I'm in jam sessions today and players are playing, and a musician comes up and we call them jive players. You know, a musician comes up and they try to, okay, they're going to try to steal the show and play. A bebop musician will go, okay, let's call Donna Lee. All right, hey, how about we call Cherokee at 300? Let's go ahead and get this musician off the bandstand and show he absolutely cannot hang. And so we have Cherokee, boom, 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 boom. And now the musician has to play, boom, 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 and all of a sudden, okay, they step aside. So again, a way to separate ourselves from the rest of the mainstream musicians that are just, say, cutting it. So yes, we still to this day try to embarrass musicians if we think they're stealing the show and just shucking and jiving and going up there and playing commercially. You'll see that a lot with like smooth jazz players that are like really popular. They play the horn, they're getting into it. They take the horn off their face. They look like stars and they're like, okay, well, let's play some bebop and kind of separate them aside and put them in their place to say. Also use secret reharmonizations and chord substitutions. one of my jobs at the University of Florida is teaching jazz theory and jazz harmony and how to teach these people, these really sophisticated high-end nuances of harmony about how they can sound. How do you, when you get on a major chord, how do you create the most color? When you get on a dominant chord, how do you create the most color out of this chord? Where are the most dense notes that are really, really juicy? And we're teaching them super Locrian scales and Lydian sharp 11 scales and Locrian sharp 2 scales. And, you know, all these kind of sophisticated things that make their playing separate and go apart. It was ultimately trial by fire, initiation process designed to identify who was hip and who was square. And at this point, I'm going to play you a couple of my bebop solos. I'm going to play you a little trumpet solo and a little EVI solo. This trumpet solo, I wrote this big band chart. It's called Needing You. And in the chart Needing You, it's the trumpet solo comes in after a big, long intro and all this stuff and the trombone players, and it's changing styles constantly. It starts off first as a ballad, then goes into bossa nova, then goes into Latin, and then by the time it gets to my solo, it's bebop. It goes into high energy, kind of a bebop solo. And I happen to have the transcription for you. How many of you read music? A few of you? Well, I'll try to follow along with the cursor so you can see it. And what I'm trying to do as a bebop player is not only am I trying to outline the harmony at the highest levels, but I'm also trying to use the entire idiomatic range of the horn to separate myself. To this day, I always say for my bebop players, okay, hey, let me hear you play some of my transcriptions. If you can play them, you're ready. I'll give you the music and all you have to do is play along. You don't have to even improvise the solo, but if you can play my solo, I know that you actually have the technical ability kind of to play bebop. So let me see if I can find one of these here. Here it is right here. I'll pull it up. I'll play the end of that too because the end is cool. All right. Did you guys like that solo there? Hold on. Let me get my screen back here. How many people like that trumpet solo? All right, so you can see how it would be kind of very difficult for other trumpet players just to play it, let alone improvise over the chord changes and do that. That's kind of what the bebop era was. The bebop era was, let's separate ourselves from the rest of the herd. Let's use the whole range of the instrument, all the technical abilities of the horn, just having the fingers and the ability to do it. I'm gonna play you just a couple more here. Let me play, how many people have ever heard of the,
you have a question, Jack? Yes, Back earlier on, one of the words that popped out to me was frenetic. In other words, it's crazy. But looking at the script, if you want to call it, while you played it, seems to me you don't play it. You've got to feel it and just let it flow.
Yeah, you can't make decisions not flowing. You don't. You have, you know, micro milliseconds to hear things, to listen to the rhythm section, and to make choices. It definitely is a language.
You really try to memorize the whole thing, or does it just come out sort of randomly?
No, you can't memorize it. No, it's just a matter of knowing the chord changes. So I have a set of chord changes that I'm playing to, and I just start improvising based on my ability to play the scales, my jazz vernacular. Remember, the jazz bebop, it's an actual language. You can actually write it out like you would Japanese or Arabic or anything like that. You don't hear it necessarily because you guys necessarily don't hear the language, but it starts off with harmonic minor scales. Ba ba da ba da ba da ba dee ba. That would be like a shape of a vocabulary word, and that would turn into sa sa do 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 ba dee ba do dee ba. You would expound upon it and morph it into something bebop. But it is an actual language, and we can actually codify all the different jazz vocabulary words and jazz languages that various players use over scales, and then actually emulate them using their own jazz vocabulary. So there's a vocabulary. So it looks like what I'm playing is actually random, but there is a source of vocabulary that I'm drawing on to actually play. It's never the same, but in much the same way when you give a speech, you're using words and it's never the same twice in a row, but you're drawing on what you know in certain sentence structures and things like that.
So like if you make a mistake, it's so covered up in the frenetic pace, you don't recognize it.
Well, interesting enough, it's glad that you said that, because mistakes, we always say in jazz, the wrong notes are the new right notes. And a lot of people don't understand that, but let me explain that so that you understand it. Let's say if I play a wrong note and I go, and I play a wrong note, what I do is I use compositional integrity to make that the new right note. I'll go, I'll say, wow, that was a wrong note. It was a wrong thing. But then I'll follow it up with this. And now I've turned it into a composition. I've turned that wrong note into a bigger piece of the puzzle that actually made it sound like the new right note. Does that make sense? Yeah.
Yes and no.
Yeah, sometimes the most beautiful things that you play in a solo are the wrong note, where you just happen to actually end on the wrong note. And you're like, what was that? And you're like, I'm going to evolve that wrong note until it becomes the new anchor to what is the next part of the solo. All right. So now how many people have heard the EVI, the electronic valve instrument? We saw a little bit of the playing. I'm gonna play a little example of electronic valve instrument transcription, so you can see the notes going by. And this is, again, it's using bebop language morphed into my own way to really expand using multiple octaves and a wide range of instruments. And again, in bebop, we're trying to separate ourselves from the other people. We don't want people to be able to play our solos. We want, if you're going to be able to play our solos, you better be really great on your instrument. We want to redefine the range of the instrument. We want to redefine the technical ability of the instrument so that we can set ourselves apart. That's kind of what the whole bebop thing is. And that's the way we win jobs and win gigs and become jazz directors and all those kind of things. All right, here's a little bit of EVI. I hope you like it. This is on a wonderful Hank Mobley tune called Home at Last. Thank you. right, so that's the EVI. And I'm gonna stop sharing the screen here. How many people have ever heard an instrument like that? Pretty different, huh? And I'm using all of the range, like a large range, over 3 octaves, 3.5 octaves there. And also, one of the things is, you don't know it, but if as my jazz musicians in my program go and they analyze that solo and they go through, it sounds random. They realize I'm actually, while I'm improvising, I'm using all of the most advanced structures and advanced harmonic options on every single chord. So if it's dominant sharp 11, I'm using pentatonic flat 6 scales. If it's an altered chord and altered dominant, I'm using super Locrian scales that have flat 9, flat 5, flat 5, or flat 9, sharp 9, flat 5, sharp 5. You know, if it's major chords, I'm using Lydian scales. And it's just actually improvised using those wonderful harmonic structures. Hold on 1 second here. That's Jose. Next week, we're going to have one of my favorite players of all time. I really encourage you guys to come in next week to hear Jose Valentino. I think Jose Valentino, who is coming in, he's our new music business head. He has, again, 52 Downbeat Awards. I think 53 now. He won a Grammy. He's been nominated for 2 others. He is one of the most, I think, modern musicians of our time. I honestly think that of Jose Valentino. He plays saxophone, flute, bass, raps, sings, keyboard. He's just absolutely extraordinary. And we're getting ready to do some albums this summer. We were on the phone last night for an hour talking about all the fun stuff that we're going to do and how we're going to do it. But he'll be on next week and you'll be able to hear a little bit of him play. And I promise you will be so blown away. You have never, this will be one of the greatest jazz musicians that you've ever heard play when you get to hear Jose, and he will be next week. I know we're running out of time here in terms of other bebop stuff, but I'm gonna field some questions. I have another hour of PowerPoint on bebop. I'm gonna skip to the end and talk about some things, but let me go ahead and field some questions from you all if you have any. Go ahead, Keith. Oh, your sound is off.
Yeah, the question is how that, you know, I was surprised I was able to approximately follow the musical score when that music was going on. You could find those pretty well. I mean, the individual notes, not really, but the question is how was that musical score created? I mean, the thought of how we're doing that, is that done electronically these days or somebody sitting there writing it down?
Interesting enough, one of my musicians that came under me, Kevin Hicks, who was my undergraduate student, he was really good. He developed really fast. And I said, you know, hey, Kevin, I really want to try to get you into the real music scene. This was in Utah, and I ended up auditioning him for Universal Studios Japan. We got him auditioned, and he made Universal Studios Japan at 19 years old and went out there and came back. And when he came back from Universal Japan, he wanted to go to grad school. So he went to UNT to finish actually part of his undergrad. And then he actually came back to UF, the University of Florida, to study grad school with me. And I was very honored by that because Kevin played lead trombone in the 1 o'clock jazz band right before that, which is the largest jazz school in the world, where he was going to school and he played lead trombone. He rose to the top and he's like, I'm coming back to grad school. I want to spend a couple more years with you, Scott. And I was like, great. Wow, this is fantastic. He came back and we recorded that album together. Kevin Hicks actually transcribed all of my solos on that album. Let me tell you how extraordinary this guy did. Excuse me. He transcribed those solos by listening to it by ear, sitting in front of his TV while watching TV with no piano, nothing, anything, with a music score and a tape player. So he would play 4 bars of it and he would write it out. He would play 4 bars and rewind it and write it out. He hand wrote that out by hand and then went and put it into the computer. And he did that for the entire album for my solos and his solos. Kevin Hicks also just transcribed Jose Valentino's new classical score composition that he's writing for Jose also, his Latin Grammy he just won was for best classical composition. So Jose improvised for like 5 minutes and Kevin Hicks wrote it all out by hand. Multimeter. So actually by ear, that solo was transcribed. And I told Kevin, I said, Kevin, if you can transcribe my solos, if you can do that, you're one of the baddest musicians. If you can just sit down there and transcribe my solos, you are really, and Kevin was like, transcribe it. He's like, I'm going to just sit down here and watch TV with the score and transcribe it. No problem. I've never really actually seen anybody do it like that. Ironically, interesting story about Kevin Hicks when he was a freshman in college and he came in and I was teaching at Snow College. He came into the oral skills class. And he came in the first day as a freshman. I met him. I'm like, hey, nice to meet you, Kevin. And I gave a little pre-oral skills test. And I saw him just write it out the first time. Like normally, you know, you have five playings and the kids are just trying to get the notes and get the rhythms. And Kevin Hicks just wrote it out the first time. And I walked over to him and I said, wow, this is you really extraordinary at just hearing music. I said, can I give you the final exam right now for the class at the end of the 15 weeks, can I give it to you? And he's like, sure. He's super mellow guy. He's like, yeah, sure, why not? And I'm like, all right. So I gave him the final exam. He did it in one take. And I was just like, okay, you don't need to come to class for the rest of the semester. And and the class was at 8 o'clock in the morning and Kevin was not an early riser. No, he had all kinds of problems. Again, so he was so grateful he didn't have to wake up at 8 o'clock every morning and come to oral skills class. Anyway, he became one of my dear friends, and to this day is one of my dear friends. I literally just recommended him for the Jazz Education Network conference last night. I wrote a recommendation letter for him for the to present at this year's conference. So, interesting questions. Any other things about those transcriptions or the solos? All right, well, we're going to close up here. I'm just going to give you a couple more tidbits about the bebop era. And show you some things here. Excuse me. And we'll just skip through some of this stuff. I'll just tell you that Milton's and Clark Munro's and the Street were some of the big places where bebop was developing. The Street was actually a bunch of clubs where people were going. And Milton's Playhouse and Clark Munro's. Excuse me. Throat is a little dry. Again, by design, bebop was dramatically different than swing. Radical elements of bebop was the bebop rhythm, boop beep ba dee ba doo doo beep bop bo beep ba doo dee ba boo ba bop. The harmony, the melody, the repertoire was really hard. Today, we still teach the bebop repertoire of the greats to get musicians great. Characteristics of bebop is it's usually high-spirited, positive, joyful music, simple arrangements. The emphasis on lengthy improvised solos, extremely fast tempos. And we have Dizzy Gillespie, Bird, and Monk as some of the key ingredients and key developers of bebop. I have a whole thing here about Dizzy Gillespie and Bird and Monk. Dizzy Gillespie was that trumpet player who had the horn that you know, angled up and his cheeks filled up really big. He was outstanding. As one of the big, huge creators of bebop, one of the greatest trumpet players of all time. Then we have Charlie Parker, very short-lived life. He only lived to be 35 years old. Again, he was ridden with drug abuse and these kinds of things. So when the coroner actually, analyzed Charlie Parker's body after he died, he thought he was 55 and he wasn't. That's how riddled his body had been from drugs. Going through here, I have all kinds of stuff on Charlie Parker that would be great that you guys would love to know. But he and Dizzy were the kind of pioneers of bebop along with Thelonious Monk. Thelonious Monk, I don't know how many people have heard of Thelonious Monk. Most people, you talk about bebop, like most people don't understand bebop and don't like bebop. Even a smaller crowd like Thelonious Monk, a very, very small amount of people like Thelonious Monk because his music was so esoteric and so different. He played like no other pianist. He played very, very, angular adjunct. He did very unconventional things using notes and half steps together. It was what we called out. It was really out there. I'm going to play one more thing from you. Other important bebop figures were Bud Powell, Kenny Clark, Charlie Christensen, Max Roach, and one of my favorite players of all time, Dexter Gordon. You guys should write that name down, Dexter Gordon. You would like Dexter Gordon. He is more of a melodic bebop player, and Dexter Gordon Ballads is one of my favorites. He's just a beautiful player, beautiful, gorgeous tenor saxophone sound. Most players getting into bebop can go through the doors of Chet Baker and Dexter Gordon to kind of develop a palette for it. And then you got Fats Navarro, Tad Dameron, Oscar Peterson. I'm going to play a little bit of Oscar Peterson here to close out and then talk about the backlash. My last slide here, the backlash of bebop, the new emerging sound. Bebop was so out there that the commercial radio couldn't sell it. People didn't want to listen to it. So we start having this new emerging sound of rhythm and blues. Like, this is where Elvis Presley starts coming from and all this stuff gained popularity, and jazz slipped into the cornerstone. So we have jazz as the mainstream, swing music is, it's the most popular music, like rock and roll. It's the rock and roll of the era. And then as all of a sudden with bebop, we see jazz slide down into art listening and stuff. And we see the emergence of rhythm and blues and all these other bands that we studied in the 60s and rock and roll, where people like, they like that simple listening palette. They like hearing the vocalist. They didn't just want instrumentalists. They wanted to hear "You Ain't Nothing But a Hound Dog" and the Beatles and the Doors and all these kind of things. And then we have the New Orleans Revival musicians of the 1920s who ended their career, suddenly found they were in demand for concerts with the New Orleans Revival. I'm going to play you one more thing here. Let's see if we can, well, there's some Dizzy Gillespie, maybe two short little clips here. This is Dizzy Gillespie in one of his heydays, and you'll hear his trumpet playing. Yeah, a little Dizzy there. You hear those fast notes. And then you hear Charlie, I'll skip that because we heard a little bit of that. Let's hear a little bit of Oscar Peterson here, one of my favorite pianists. Wow. Did you hear how heavy that was? Did you hear that technique in there?
Yes.
Oh my gosh, Oscar Peterson. I highly recommend. I still think Oscar Peterson is literally the greatest pianist of all time. What he could do on the piano, that's a small sampling, but most of the players deem him like the greatest jazz pianist of all time. All right, so we're running out of time here. Have you guys all learned a little bit about bebop? All right. That is awesome. That is awesome. I'm glad I could shed a little bit of light on it and what it is and how it came about and who are the main players and some of the solos and share with you why it's considered an art form instead of just a music. And hopefully with that, you are now officially all beboppers.
That's great. Do we have time for a couple of questions?
Oh, absolutely. Let's hear some questions.
Any questions before we go here?
One comment. I love Oscar Peterson. And one of the things I get a kick of in listening to his recordings carefully often is, especially if he's playing in some kind of nightclub somewhere, some, you know, unofficial kind of place, is you'll hear his vocalizations along with the piano. He's scatting kind of as he's playing, and you know, he'll play these wild strings of a series of notes, and he'll have all of it. And you can hear him mumbling into a microphone. I guess there's a microphone there. I don't know. I hear him anyway. It's really funny to listen to that.
Yeah, it almost sounds like mumbling. It'll start out like, and the piano mic is actually picking him up.
Okay. Yeah, anyone else? One time for one last question.
I have one, Diane. It's Diane. You talk about jam sessions often, and could you just explain what they are? Who can be part of them? Is there a leader? Do you have music? What's going on with jam sessions?
Well, a jam session is usually where players come to learn how to cut their teeth on the music. So we have some of these on Wednesday nights at the Bull, and I'm gonna get a list to Don of where all these things that are happening in town. I'm holding off on that list, and I haven't sent it because Jose Valentino and I have just booked 6 new dates at the Keys Piano Bar and Grill, where we're gonna showcase our group and different stuff. And also at the Bull, where everything is kind of changing here towards the end of the semester, and the gigs that were already planned are already planned. Our jazz series is over, but we're starting up a new thing, a new jazz series here that's going to go through till about mid-May, where people can play. But the jam sessions, like at the Bull, are where people can come. They can wait on the sidelines and get their turn, and they don't know necessarily what tune is going to be called. So finally, when their chance comes up, they're like, okay, you've been waiting in line. You're the sax player. You come up. All right, we're playing. What is this thing called? La, ba, ba, do, ba, ba, da. And if they don't know the melody, they have to suffer. They have to try to get through the chord changes. But eventually they rise to the top. If they show up to enough jam sessions, they're like, all right, I know those 10 tunes. When you go to a jam session and you don't know a tune and you're just embarrassed and you have to get off the bandstand, what do? You go home and you learn that tune. You come back next week, and when they call that tune, you're ready to go and fire away. That's kind of what the jam sessions are. And it's an opportunity for younger musicians to meet older musicians and connect with them and learn their things. So there's a lot of conversations going on the side while other musicians are playing. They're talking about records to listen to. They're talking about transcription books to check out. They're talking about melodies, perhaps that might be on the next week's jam session. You know, hey, why don't you learn On Green Dauphin Street? Why don't you learn My Secret Love? And I'll call those tunes and pull you up and give you a chance for success. It's a chance for older players to mentor the young players. And jam sessions are where we all get our start as jazz musicians. There aren't a lot of jam sessions anymore, so it's really hard to get those opportunities. And you can't just play in your room by yourself and learn how to play with a rhythm section. It's like playing basketball by yourself. You're not going to learn how to interact with the players and how the game is played. So you have to be on the bandstand to learn that. And those jam sessions are really important to the young evolving players.
Great. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Scott. I know I speak for everyone here this morning in saying how much we appreciate your sharing your talent with us. We certainly learned a lot. And next week, as Scott said, we're in for a very special experience when he'll be joined by one of his new faculty colleagues, Jose Valentino. I suggest we all spread the word. If you have friends who are not registered in the class, they're welcome to come to the Oak Room and share this experience with us next week. So thank you, Scott. We really appreciate it.
One more thing. Thank you so much. One more thing is we have the Splendor event, and that Splendor event is the Fine Arts Gala, and it's on April 10th. And I highly recommend you go. Next week, I'm going to play you a little sample of the video of what's going to happen at that event and all the different things. It's showcasing theater and dance and showcasing music and orchestra and jazz, little snip clips. And it's hosted by Ryan, this guy who's just an amazing host. And we're hoping some of you might want to attend our Splendor event on April 10th.
Well, thank you, Scott, for that plug. In fact, I'm thrilled to announce that we've got about 25 people who live here at Oak Hammock who are signed up to enjoy Splendor here in the Oak Room.
Woo! All right. Thank you so much. Have a great time this week.
Thank you, Scott. Thank you.
It was great.
All right.